Good morning, Nick here. I've got a little bit of laryngitis starting because I've been doing a lot of videos and talking. Some of them aren't uploaded yet, but today I'm going to take a break and work in my garage on making glasses. Oh, there goes the AC. But anyway, I'm going to give you a quick tour of my backyard here because this is my main business, is urban micro farms. And this is just my nursery area here. I started this in 2009. I used to be a candle maker for about 18 years on a company called Global Candle Gallery. We had a lot of stores all over the place, up to 20 at one point. And we were the largest on-site candle making company in the world, basically. I was the original artist and wrote 3 patents for them. You can still look them up. They've got a lot of stores called Global Candle Gallery. Anyway, I started Urban Microfarms in 2009 because I didn't like the produce I was seeing in the stores, and I'd been growing food for a long time. So I want to show other people how to do that. So this is my orchid house here. I store bamboo and things like that up there because that gives them a little bit of shade. So I propagate plants here, and I attach orchids to wood, and then slowly they start taking over the wood. And here's a great example of that happening. And these roots are nice because the roots that are on the roots follow all these little grooves and channels in there. These are in various stages of attaching themselves. This one is fully attached and about to bloom, actually. I have not seen this one bloom yet. It is a sort of new species. I don't know the species of a lot of these because I got them from friends and they didn't know or whatever. Sometimes I find orchids in the woods and we'll bring them back. So this one's really attached. You can see right here. These roots are just, it's great to see that. It's just life energy in those roots. And you can see the new little root right there. Those things are just jamming along. Orchids are fairly easy to take care of. It's kind of a myth that it's hard. You basically attach them to the wood, to give them some stuff so they don't dry out, and some chips and a few other things. And I water mine daily. Sometimes it's raining, I don't have to mess with it, and feed them, you know, with the light feeding every week, except in winter. You don't feed them in winter. Anyway, that's orchids. But Urban Microfarms teaches people how to grow food. I build raised beds. I do everything from showing them how to do it, or I come and do it for them. A lot of different methods. This is a cypress 16 foot by 4 bed here by 2 feet deep. These are tile crate garden beds. Excuse me. This is 2 tile crates put end to end. And this is a giant coral head, Florida coral head garden. I moved all these rocks here over the years. When I'd find one I liked, I would bring it home. And you can imagine, they're not easy to move around. I probably have some back issues from that. So this thing is a giant garden bed with a walkway down the middle. And what I do is I go to the chicken pen, and I pick up probably 10,000 pounds of compost from an organic grocery store locally called Rollin' Oats. And they're very nice, and they help me with a lot. So I dump a lot of stuff in here for the chickens. She's busy eating a roach over there. One is brooding, so she's not coming out. But anyway, I take all this after I've put, probably 1,000 pounds, maybe 2,000 pounds of stuff on this over 6 months, and I'll till this in with my tiller, and then I'll transport all that straight into these beds here. Let it sit for a while, because some of the chicken manure is fresh in there, but a lot of it's composted. And this is also my mystery garden. This is where I throw old seed packets inside here, and when it's time to spring plant, I take all my fall stuff, which is still kicking butt, like kale and other greens and collards, and transplant those into here so they can continue, and real carefully too, so they can continue to give you food, and then eventually probably go to seed. So this thing pops up all kinds of different things. This is an African wampi tree here. Tom Clark gave that to me about 20 years ago. This is cardamom, galanga, ginger, turmeric, papayas. This is a melon that's coming up that I planted. This is a plant right here, this vine, that grows along the seashore, really salty environments. I brought it back here because it has a really neat flower. And I just stuck the vine in the ground and boom, there it goes. This log bed, I do a lot of them with logs, and basically just cut. This is one of my first ones. I wasn't really trying to make it look nice for my own purposes, but this has a Hugelkultur bed underneath, which is a giant trench with wood in it, and that adds nutrients and acts like a sponge. But that was years and years ago. I flattened that down and put this log bed over it. So inside of here are asparagus, and that's what you see these shoots. See the asparagus right there? Right there. And that, you know, you can just eat it, but you got to let these frond up and do their thing. And that's, these are all asparagus fronds. They get up to about 5 feet tall. I think we have marjoram back there. This is really some really nice oregano. Then I propagate plants. This tree right here is a crazy tree. This is a custard apple tree. And if you have never eaten a custard apple, look at that thing. Looks like a grenade. Look at them. This is the first year that it's given me fruit. But there's a lot of them on there. The bananas need to be trimmed because they're kind of beaten up on each other. So I'm going to get those off each other with a knife later. But this thing probably has, knock on wood, 20 or so custard apples. And the bananas are kicking butt. Strawberries, moringa trees. This is a papaya that's just seeded itself. Now that moringa's fallen. More custard apple trees. Basil I'm letting go to seed. You gotta have a lot of flowers when you garden. This is red amaranth here. Amaranth was eaten by the Aztecs. They gave it to their warriors. That's one of the foods that was given to only warriors. And I think quinoa was for the Inca. And they would reserve these high protein or high energy foods for the warriors. This right here, and there's a bee on it. Very nice. Hi, bee. Well, this is called Tulsi, T-U-L-S-I basil, otherwise known as sacred basil in India. I'm growing a ton of that. It's really, really aromatic and pungent. I mean, that stuff is really amazing. And it's supposed to be very good for you. They actually worship it there. So I'm growing it to figure out why they're worshiping it. This is more purslane here. Now, this is one I got from the store just because it was on sale and they're letting them die. So I bring them back here and stick them in the ground. The natural purslane that grows here in Florida, and they might all be, I'm sure they're all edible. But purslane, and I can't say this strongly enough, everyone out there, you need to eat a lot of omega-3s. And this plant right here has the highest amount of omega-3s, and the good omega-3s in the world. At least that's what I've read and have been told. Over here, let's see, the bananas. And I've got a lot of work to do. I've been doing a lot of digging and a lot of other things. And these are my cucumbers. This is a Suyo cucumber. It's trellising up here to this line. And then there's another one going to go up that line over there. And then I'm going to make cross lines and have a cucumber tunnel with cucumbers like this hanging in there. Look at that thing. That is, let's see, 9, probably 16 inches long. Thank you, cucumber plant. I'm going to take that. And when you grow cucumbers, there's a few things you got to do. Here, you got to spray them with BT about every week to stop the caterpillars from eating them. So let me line these up here. And also, you got to pick them. You don't have to pick them all, but when they start getting a pretty decent size, you got to pick them so they'll keep making cucumbers. As soon as the plant thinks that it's produced enough seeds to propagate itself and continue on, then it will stop producing fruit. Another thing is, these have, like tomatoes, little suckers. Here's one right here. And you pinch that off. And you find other ones. Look, there's another sucker. What it does, the plant will keep on growing these vines all over the place and out and out and out and out. And it puts all its energy into vegetative growth instead of producing fruit. So when you cut all these little things off, it stops sending energy to that thing. And there's one that got away from me. Gotta be careful. This one is, yep, see ya. And you might feel, oh my God, it's got a flower on it. What? It's the plant just keeps going like we should. Just, you get arm torn off, just keep going. Or as the berserkers used to actually, if their forearm was cut off in battle, there's a thing called the Fountain of Valhalla. And the Fountain of Valhalla is where your forearm is cut off, and you actually, I was a medic in the army, you have a about a minute, maybe less, someone correct me if I'm wrong, before you will start gushing blood. That's because it's the body's natural instinct. When it's amputated, the muscles around the end clamp and actually keep you from dying. So it's self-preservation mode. And my ancestors in Scotland were berserkers, and they would, they probably didn't want to die. I don't think they would just die, but they didn't call it the Fountain of Valhalla for nothing. So they would spray their opponent in the eyes and try to kill them with one last blow before they bled out. So, okay, so that's the cucumber area, future beds here. One thing I can't stress enough is if you have city water in your gardening, get a Boogie Blue filter. These things take the chloramine out and the chlorine. Well, 99% of chlorine, about 89% of the chloramines, heavy metals, leads, and things like that. So this bed, what I'm doing right now is taking some bamboo stakes and getting my okra staked up so I can start spraying the ants. There's a bunch of ants in there. And what the ants do is they farm aphids. Aphids are these little dots you see on the underside of the plant. And those little things hook onto the veins of the plant and suck its chlorophyll. So we don't want that happening. It's easy enough, you just spray them, but not enough to hurt the leaf, but enough to knock them off of there. And the ants will come back and put them back again because they're industrious little shits. And what they're doing is the aphids are hooked in with their mouth and their butt is in the air. I guess whatever they have for a butt. And they when they take a crap, a little green ball comes out of their butt. And then the freaking ants grab that and take it back to the nest and feed the babies. And so, yeah, it's a symbiotic relationship for real, big time. But it's a pain in the ass symbiotic relationship. So anyway, it's still, once you get the plants past a certain stage, they'll start going crazy. And these okras will get, these okras will get, and this bed probably 7 feet tall because they're already bumped up off the ground. As my composting area over here, it's going pretty heavy. Anyway, that's just a quick roundup of my main business. I'm going to cut it off now because I'm losing my voice. And many of you probably have to do a lot of videos, probably run into that problem. But anyway, that's it. I'll see you next time.